it's kind of after time, so let's start. Yeah, I've had a number of emails saying Hodjam blah 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 or whatever, with reference to this terrible deadline on Friday this week. Now, as you know, I am a sympathetic, kind of a person, so we can have a little extension. We can't extend things too far because, as well as the fact that I have to read your essays, I also, for this first essay, will see all of you for about 15 minutes to give you feedback and information in my constructive criticism so that you can take that on board and write a second essay that's even better. And obviously with my library job especially, it means I have to juggle all sorts of stuff. So in terms of arranging, what I'm going to try and do, there's something on Moodle called Scheduler, where I create a set of times and then you can come along and click one of them and then you can book yourself in. So instead of in the old days, I used to bring a piece of paper and say, okay, when can you come, when can you come? We'll do it online, and I'll tell you about that next week, okay? So that I'll be able to see who's coming when. And I'll do it over about 3 days, so that if you've got a class on a certain day and the other guys don't, they can come that time, and then if there's other times that you can't fit in, we'll arrange it. But and I'll obviously, with kind of over 20 people in the class, it'll take me over a week to read all the essays, because I'll try and do it thoroughly. So we need the essays in, then I need to read them, then we need to make the time to see each other, and we don't want to end up still negotiating by the end of January or something ridiculous like that. So what I'm thinking of is, instead of Friday this week, you can finish your essays, you can give them to me in class on Tuesday next week. So that only gives like 3 or 4 extra days, but maybe that's yeter enough for some, if not all of you, okay? That's pushing it back then. I'd like to get going with the essays then. I mean, I must say, a couple of you emailed and I sent sort of, okay, I'll think about it, but Amma, and then I said, you should have started earlier. And so I know you're all very busy. I know all the teachers are pressing you. I know it's also midterm time, which affecting the undergraduates especially, and so on. But we did start discussing these essays all the way back in kind of middle or towards the end of September, and I gave my little speech probably, we can check the video recording if you want, about this disease, last minuteism and all that. So maybe I did, I can't remember now. But so I can be flexible. I can add a little bit of time on, but I don't, for various reasons, both practical ones, but also intellectual ones, I don't want to push too far back. So a week, I feel, would be a little bit much. Okay, so I can give you all till Tuesday next week, and I'd like the essays in on Tuesday. What I might do, therefore, is create an account with the Turnitin, so you can submit your essays via Turnitin, so that we can check for similarity, let's put it that way, in various ways, which isn't, I'm hoping we will see none of that at all. So I'll try and remember to do that after the class. Hi, welcome. So I shall send an announcement out when I get to my office after the class. So whatever it is, 4:30, saying next Tuesday deadline rather than Friday this week, okay? Tamam? Right. That'll have to be enough anyway, that's all we're going to give. In the meantime, well, my office hours yesterday, and usually I have very busy office hour and I'm complaining, saying everyone keeps coming and I never have had time to get the class ready. No one came yesterday, so I had plenty of time to talk to Paul, do some work. And but there isn't, apart from next Monday, which is a bit late, you can come and see me next Monday, but then that gives you less than 24 hours in which to make any big changes. If you have any questions, if you want to send me kind of early drafts, Oksana, you wanted to talk to me about the essay, for example, then you can try and contact me at any point between now and next Tuesday as well. Whether you can get to see me in person is obviously more difficult. This morning we were making all sorts of plans in the library to meet about this then and this then and this then, so my schedule is filling up. Plus, for some reason, just because I come from Wales, the librarian in Bliss at the school wants me to go on Friday morning and read some poetry by Dylan Thomas, who's a famous Welsh poet, dead now, obviously. But he comes from South Wales, and I don't have a very South Welsh accent at all. So because I come from Wales, so even though I'm not even going to be around campus on Friday morning for part of the time. But so any questions about your essay, any specific things, any concerns, you can let me know, okay? Murat?
Are we expected to submit hard copy, printed copies, or?
Now, if we go with Turnitin, then I shall get the hard copy myself. History Department can pay for the printing from Turnitin. Okay, so.
We submit through Turnitin. Is it through STARS?
I'll do it through the Moodle version of Turnitin, and then you'll have a login information. Probably you can do it via Moodle as well. I'm not sure exactly. I've done it two ways in the past. I've done it through Turnitin and set up a Turnitin account, but since I'm using Moodle for this course, and you all should be there, I think if you go to Moodle, there'll be a thing say, upload your essay, and then it'll be uploaded for you there. If there's a problem, let me know, okay? Because I will set an end date as a deadline. So Turnitin is not as flexible as me, obviously, because at a certain point the computer just shuts down for that. But I can submit things late myself if there's a problem or something like that, okay? Any other questions? No? Anything else? Right. In the time we have left, without Alp and Fatih, but I think Alp, being an intellectual kind of a person, philosopher, he's going to do the Carolingian Renaissance, I think. And I think Fatih wanted to focus on Charlemagne. So what I shall do today is more generally talk about the Carolingians as a kind of background, maybe say a few things, but I don't want to overlap too much with what they're going to say. So Friday we will have two presentations. It's a little bit heavier than usual. Okay. The Carolingians were a dynasty of Frankish kings and later also emperors who ruled a large part of Western and Central Europe from officially 751 until 2 dates, effectively. In 911, in what at that point we sometimes call Eastern Francia, which effectively is kind of the ancestor of modern Germany, a different dynasty took over, and we'll have a look at the history of Germany in the Central Middle Ages in a few weeks' time. And in 987, in Western Francia, which becomes France, another dynasty, different dynasty, takes over. So the kind of idea that there was a Carolingian Empire ruled by different groups of Carolingians breaks up, and we have two kind of successor states. The Carolingians also, largely because of the influence of their most famous member, which is Charlemagne, extended their influence into the northern, northeastern part of what is now Spain. Hi, come in. Yeah, okay. So you've all been to this thingamajig, this assistant thing or whatever. Okay. Well, I'm glad to see Fatih and Alp at least, as they're both giving their presentations today.
The rest of them.
No. this week. This week. Okay. So obviously, I think now you're going to do the Renaissance, Carolingian Renaissance. Fatih, Charlemagne. Okay. As I was just saying, I'm going to do more general stuff about the Carolingians and a few points and so on today to put things into a broader context. So the Carolingians. Yeah. Okay. Let's all settle down now. The Carolingians had some influence in the Frankish world before that. We'll say about that in a minute. But officially, their first king as such, 751, and ruling until various points early or later in the 10th century in the kind of first the East disappearing and then finally the West. So in not a very, very long time, I mean, less than 200 years, slightly over 200 years elsewhere, but they were very, very important for a whole host of political, economic, intellectual, cultural reasons and so on. And today, and in more detail, I hope on Friday, we shall be examining these things. Ha! Footnote. For those of you who just arrived, I have graciously, in my great magnanimity, I have agreed to give a small extension on the essay deadline. So we have, oh no, you have, until Tuesday. Tuesday next week. Don't push your luck, sonny boy. Till Tuesday next week to submit the essays. And today, at some point, I shall create the Turnitin account via Moodle. I think that's doors locked, in fact, Elif. So you have to come this way in front of the camera. And so you'll have until at some point on Tuesday next week, okay, to submit the essay via Moodle, I think, to Turnitin, which will then scan for similarity, which I will then decide whether we count that as plagiarism or something else. We don't have a formal office hour until next Tuesday, but Monday. But if any of you have any questions, if you want me to look at a draft, if you have any concerns or something, you can contact me by other means before Tuesday next week, I hope. Okay, so that's the chronological thing. And as we were just saying, the Carolingians coming to dominate, expanding what had been the Frankish empire of the Merovingians somewhat, pushing into what is northern Spain, as we were saying, dominating the northern part of Italy as well, and pushing the kind of eastern boundaries of Christendom, let's use Latin Christendom, further eastwards into what is now Germany, into the, what was then, of course, we might call Germania, and bringing kind of Western Christianity into contact with Slavic peoples of various sorts as well. And that's very important for something I shall say now. Any ideas why they're called Carolingian? Where does that name come from? Carolingian? What in modern English is pronounced Charles, in French Charles, of course. In medieval Latin, was something like this, Carolus, okay. If we put... if we put the genealogy of the Carolingians up... okay, we can't get it all on there, but okay. I'll say a little bit about Charles Martel, Charles the Hammer, in a minute. There was one of the Charles... There was another one, this is Charlemagne, his brother Carloman, obviously some kind of compound name there involving the element Carolus Charles as well. We get a Charles the Younger here. If we go to the later period, what do we get here? We should have a few more Charleses. Where is, okay, Charles the Bald. And to be honest with you, don't ask me, did he have any hair or not? I have absolutely no idea. I'm sure if you look on Wikipedia, you'll find out why he got that nickname, okay? Another Charles here, another Carloman, some Charles down there, another Charles the Fat, okay, or whatever, and plenty of them. There's so many Charleses, they had to all have these nicknames. So Charles was their big name, but probably it is because of... Carolus Magnus, Charlemagne, as we have in a kind of Frankified form, that their name comes from. Okay, they are the family of the greatest Carolingian, Charles the Great, as this is translated here. Sorry? They were known by the name. They were the Arnulfings. Because, and maybe on, yes, here we go, it's presumably this guy here, Arnulf, Bishop of Metz, was the ancestor of the family earlier on, and so they were called the Arnulfings, the descendants of Arnulf. I don't know a lot about Arnulf himself, obviously, as a member of the church, as a clergyman, He wasn't obviously supposed to have any children. Whether he became a bishop after later on or something, I'm not really sure. I have to look into that. But or whether he's got sort of a non-clerical children born when he was a clergyman, I'm not sure. But the important point here is his grandson, Pippin II, who becomes what is known as mayor of the palace in Austrasia, in the northeastern part of Francia, okay, and his successors down to Charles Martel, and his son Pippin continued that that tradition and so on. So they're very important administrators, and we'll come to that in a few minutes. My question to you is, what is the connection between this man and his name, and Turkish? What is his connection?
Kral.
Kral, okay. Which you can see, you might get the some of the elements moved around and so on. Charlemagne pushing, oh, it's gone. Charlemagne pushing the borders of the Frankish kingdom further eastwards, as I said, and then coming into contact with Slavic peoples, and being such a great and famous king, at some point, this is what's understood, the Slavic people, because they were kind of pre-literate at this point, so exactly how we know this, I'm not sure, but at some point, he was the king, the big Christian king that they were in contact with, and fighting sometimes, and letting him tell them what to do occasionally, and so on. And somehow, Carolus, bless you, Carolus or whatever, as or Carl or something, as he may have been called natively, his name then becomes equated with the concept or the name or the idea of king, and then obviously Turks borrow that from the Slavs in turn. So not direct contact between Turkic peoples and the Carolingians, but via this Slavic interaction as well. You may be less familiar with Scandinavian onomastics, but people from Norway, Sweden, or whatever can also be called Magnus, okay? And this goes back to, I think, Norwegian king who decided to call his son Magnus, naming him after Charles the Great, Charles Carolus Magnus, because he wanted his son to be kind of great as well. So both bits of names have fed into a word in Turkish, and this word has become a name in Scandinavian tradition as well. So his influence, not just political and so on, but also anthroponymic, we should say, as well, which is important. Okay, for the historian, the Carolingian period is very important because it kind of marks a watershed. We move, this is a very kind of simple list here, just something to for me to refer to. We move a little bit more into the light. If the early Middle Ages, as it is for many people, is the Dark Ages, and if it's dark, not necessarily because of human behavior, but because of the information that we have, then the Carolingians provide a little bit more illumination. From their period, we have a lot more sources than we do from before. So it's a bit less guesswork and a bit more, I wouldn't say hard and reliable information, but there's a little bit more for us to look at and analyze and worry about than before. So I'll just quickly run through some of these points here. Narrative sources, the sources that tell us some kind of a sequence of events, some kind of a story or whatever, we have a growing number of these here. Annals, particularly we have something called the Annales Regni Francorum. Latinists wish to translate that extremely simple three word, those extremely simple three, Annales Regni Francorum. Annales, annals, obviously, we can get that one. Regni is, yeah, regnum, which means kingdom in this case, could mean reign, is where we get the Francorum, plural genitive, of the Franks. So the Annals of the Kingdom of the Franks. I forgot to bring my... Here it is. Slightly different here. Royal Frankish Annals, as it's given in this translation there that I have. Okay. Two things to say here. Firstly, we have... Annals existed earlier. In a medieval context, or even in an ancient context, what do we understand by the word an annal, if we describe something as an annal, or annals in the plural? There is a Latin word which is the root of this, which tells us the nature of this document, in a sense. Yes. Based on the word year. Year by year, if we're lucky, every year. Sometimes years get skipped depending on how detailed or what the information was. Particularly at important monasteries, churches around Europe, it's suggested originally to try and calculate the date of Easter. People kept records of the sequences of years. And then slowly people added little things like King so-and-so died this year and so-and-so got married this year, and then these things expand until they become, by their standards, quite fairly detailed accounts of events during that year near the church or in that kingdom or wherever it might be, and so on. Okay. Secondly, these ones, obviously, Annals Regni Francorum, are royal annals. They are kept to tell the story of the Carolingian kings. So they are not just annals kept by a bunch of priests somewhere or whatever, or monks or whatever, for kind of recording purposes. They're also, to some extent, political propaganda used by the Carolingian kings. It's representing the court's interpretation of events, the official ones and things like that. Okay. There is a slightly false distinction between the idea of annals and chronicles, okay? We could suggest, and this is not perfect really, that chronicles are a more looser account of events rather than just a simple year-by-year account. But there are plenty of sources called chronica, which pretty much do the same thing as annals and vice versa. But we do get other, perhaps less chronological accounts, which we might call chronicles. In addition, we get a number of lives of Carolingian kings. Now, we talked about hagiography before the Byram, okay, the concept of saints' lives, and I talked about how up to a point they can be reliable, but later on they become increasingly unreliable as direct sources of information. Possibly partly modelled upon Christian hagiography, possibly also modelling on classical writers who wrote the lives of emperors and so on. We get a number of accounts of the lives of Carolingian kings and emperors, beginning with Charlemagne. And here I have my own Penguin Classic translation, Einhard in particular, very important. He was an advisor to Charlemagne and was connected to his court. And a little bit later, Notke the Stammerer, who had some speech impediment allegedly, wrote a similar but less sort of structured book called De Carlo Magno about or concerning Charles the Great. And again, we don't have to assume these things are absolutely, definitely reliable sources of information, but it's an important starting point compared to what we have for the Merovingians before and so on. It's a big move forward. It's a big step forward for us. In addition, we see a growing number of administrative sources. The Merovingians, the kings, but also the monasteries in the earlier period had kept things of a kind of documentary kind, but we see a growing number of administrative sources which tell us or supplement what the narrative ones tell us. Capitularies are kind of, well, they vary, but they're statements, sometimes quite short, sometimes longer, of decisions and kind of almost laws made by the king, Charlemagne, especially, okay, on certain issues, on certain points of concern of his and things like that. So it's a way of communicating, this is what everyone will be doing in my kingdom on this subject, okay, which might be to do with education, it might be to do with government administration or something like that. And he had missives, missi, who were sent out around the kingdom to pass out copies and to make sure everyone knew, or most people of importance knew, what the king had decided would be happening and so on. So it's evidence of some kind of an attempt at the central administration working with parts of the empire, which, as we can see, is quite a big one as well. And these things grow into more complex documents as we go along. So we could see, yeah, sort of decrees. They all vary, so we can't say there's a definite pattern. But decrees and decisions, some of them are longer, but describing what's been decided, what should happen, things like that, okay, on various subjects. Charters, have we mentioned charters before? What is a charter? Carta in Latin. Very important source. Not very exciting for those of you who don't like these kind of things, but for sad people like myself or my colleague Paul, charters are very interesting. Charters are what?
Legal.
Legal. Yes.
Authorization.
Yeah, they are records of transactions between people. Okay. Most of the charters that, for example, survive from the later Middle Ages involve a person, usually a wealthy person, a nobleman or whatever, recording the fact that he has given, you sometimes she, but usually he, has given some property, usually land, to a church. Okay, and in return, the church might promise to pay something, or it might promise to pray for the man's soul twice a year or something like that, depending on the situation we're in and so on. And it describes a little bit about the relationship between the people, and some early charters supposedly give us evidence of feudal relationships. We'll talk about those in a few weeks' time in a separate context. Well, cartularies are just collections of charters. Okay, we'll come to that in a short while. And we have charters that record these transactions, these interactions of a sort of financial or more economic relationship earlier on, but we have a lot more from the Carolingian period expanding, both on the continent, but also at the same time in Britain, in England as well. Cartularies, basically a little bit later on, some of the churches said, okay, we've got all this land and we've got all these things, but I've lost it. I can't prove that we have that bit of land over there. It's gone or something. Or to avoid that kind of thing happening, they say, let's just copy them all up into a cartulary. And then they go and say it's gone. They say, oh, we'll make it up. Okay, we all know we own that bit of land, so we'll just write a charter out, copy this one, but just change a few names. No one will notice. And no one does notice until the 19th, 20th century, when all these clever historians say, ah, that looks a bit suspicious or something like that. They're not all like that, but they're collections of the charters, some of them reliable, some of them not so reliable, from this later period, but also the later Middle Ages as well. And we have a number of letter collections as well, correspondence between people. Most importantly in this respect, perhaps, an individual called Alcuin. Do we know who Alcuin was? Ever heard of Alcuin? Probably, I guess his name, probably originally Alcuine, but this is how it's called normally. He was an Anglo-Saxon. Okay, Alcuin, go on. Right.
And he was a bishop, I think. And then, with the invitation of Charles the Great, he went over to the continent and became a prominent intellectual and
bishop, right?
Yes. And Christus. And he had correspondence with a lot of people, including Charles the Great. And he kind of, well, I'll be talking about him.
Right, okay, well, we won't, okay, yeah, okay, well, let's not, worse than the BBC for repeats, as I've probably said before, but, okay, but, yeah, he was a number of very important intellectuals about whom we will hear a lot more on Friday from Alp, but, and he did many things, but he also left this, by the standards of the time, quite notable collection of letters. He's writing back to people in England, his old friends, his old confreres, or whatever you want to call them, and commenting on various things. So he gives a kind of picture, personal picture of what it's like in Francia, but also he's commenting on other events as well. So various things to say about that, but we'll leave some of those till later. So these various sets of sources, all of which in one way or another existed before, but we get them in more detail. And I suppose we should put another blob here or something and write manuscripts. It is largely because of the Carolingians, for various reasons, that a lot of medieval but also classical learning has been preserved to us, at least in the Western tradition. And again, I don't want to say too much and encroach upon what Alp will be saying on Friday, but I want to use one example of a paleographic nature and get some thoughts of it. Are you going to talk about handwriting? Yes. A bit, okay. Well, we will anticipate you a bit there, but I'll show a few other things, okay. But basically, the various churches were encouraged to copy in a correct way existing texts, medieval as they were at the time, but also classical texts, and a lot of manuscripts survive from this period and later, and it's largely because of this Carolingian concern that we have a lot of things there. And in fact, if you want to become a classical scholar, if you want to become a historian of Rome, for example, then you need to read medieval handwriting, because there isn't a lot of Roman stuff that survives from the Roman period, but it survives from the Carolingian times and later. So you need to be able to read medieval handwriting rather than classical handwriting to get back to the earliest versions of many texts and so on. This is what we have here, is the script which was devised, some argue, perhaps under the influence of Alcuin, but we have no way of proving that, called Caroline Minuscule. It's been many years now, many years, I don't know how many years, 4 years or something, since I did my Latin paleography course. Maybe at some point when we have enough people to make the 5 or 6 required for the course, we can run that one again in the next few years. Fatty's looking interested in that. We haven't done it for a while because of various reasons. But then we look at the history of scripts, and I'll just do a little bit of this here now and get some of your thoughts. Caroline is another word for Carolingian, just means the Carolingians there. Minuscule means a kind of handwriting where it goes above the line and below the line as well as in the middle, okay? A script which is just like that, where you've got one line, we call majuscule. So minuscule is the word term for having kind of effectively 4 lines, I suppose you might say there. Except when I was in Cambridge doing my PhD, in the library, there was a librarian there who was very small. And Caroline is also a lady's name, as you may know, in Britain. So some people used to call her Caroline Minuscule because she was little. Her name wasn't Caroline, I don't think, but anyway. Just suddenly remembered that one there as we go along. Thank you. Right. The handwriting is not just interesting in itself, but illustrates a number of other... A number of other points which help us to kind of think about the Carolingian Renaissance and the Carolingian period in general. So we'll use this as one way of illustrating the Carolingian contribution, but with a particular reference, but it has broader, I think, implications. One of the effects of the post-Roman period, after the end of the Roman Empire, when you lose some sort of central power that up to a point, and by the end of the Roman period, I suppose we could say that the emperors and their court were really kind of standardizing and controlling people's lives very much, but even at the end of the Roman period, this would be true. But one of the effects of the very early part of our course is this decentralization politically. We've been seeing that. Roman Empire disappears and these different kingdoms appear, and even in Britain you saw lots of different kingdoms on the map there and so on. Politically speaking, but also up to a point we find that happening in a cultural way as well. Okay, distances somehow become further, and contacts between people become less, and there isn't anyone saying this is what we should all be doing and things like that. So people over there do things in one way, people over here do things in another way. And that happens in handwriting. When we look at the history of handwriting in the Roman Empire, we have certain forms which the Romans used for writing different kinds of documents, and they're all fairly similar. Even writing Latin in the Eastern Empire, where it's mostly Greek, we can see the usual forms and so on. But during the early post-Roman period, we see this decentralization. So by the late Merovingian period, we see, for example, it's not quite as extreme as this, but almost every different monastery has its own different kind of handwriting, its own script or hand, as it's sometimes called. It's not quite that extreme, but and some monasteries are connected to each other, so they have similar ones. But there are certain a certain sort of truth in that. So here, for example, is an example of what's called Luxeuil script from the monastery of Luxeuil, Luxeuil minuscule, okay. And apart from being characteristic of that church and its sister churches or whatever, it's also quite difficult to read. All right. I'm not going to ask the Latinists here to read out this, but this is the kind of thing we will do in paleography should we get a chance and so on, is to have a go at reading some of these scripts a little bit. I couldn't find a whole image for here, but here is another script called Corby AB script, I think, because of the characteristic forms of the A and the letter B. It has also a number of other interesting shapes as well, but this one is one of the ones I could find quickly before the class. And this is connected to the church, the monastery at Corby, and its associates and so on. Meanwhile, elsewhere in, oh dear, I'm clicking the wrong thing again, in Italy, we have the emergence of actually quite a nice script, depending on how close you stand to it, called Beneventan, sometimes called Lombard script. As well, okay, which has its own peculiarities for reading and understanding. I show these three examples just to show you the ways that in really what is quite a small area, we're talking about Western Europe, we're not even talking about the whole of Western Europe, we see some quite different scripts emerging within certain regions connected to particular churches and things like that. One of the things which Charlemagne especially wanted to do, and I think, again, both of our presenters might be talking about this theme on Friday, is some kind of standardization in most aspects of life, bringing some kind of unity to what was a political unity of the empire. So what we see during the second half of the 8th century, during the time of Charlemagne, is the appearance eventually, and to some extent quite quickly, of something like this. And very quickly, this is, becomes the standard handwriting that everyone is supposed to use. So it's not just that the Carolingian kings in their court have things written like this, but all the different churches within the empire are supposed to use a version of this handwriting, okay? And it's created, there are various ways, arguments of exactly how it's created. It's created from one of the old scripts, or it's combining elements of the others, or it's looking back to Roman models. We don't need to go into that so much, but it is an attempt at standardizing and then unifying the whole of the empire in terms of handwriting. It's important for them, therefore, in that sense, and it's a way of physically, visually showing this pattern which we see in other aspects of life. It's also important because the handwriting that we have today, when we write English or Turkish, when we print Times New Roman or whatever, are all descended from this. All right. Handwritings, like people, like animals, evolve and change over time. So Caroline Minuscule changes into something which is sometimes called black letter or Gothic script, and it's the pretend pseudo-medieval script that I've got on the top of the syllabus. You can get that font in most word packages and so on. And by the Renaissance, the very fine men in Italy decided that they didn't like the bit in between them and the Romans, so they called it the Middle Time, the Middle Ages, of course. And they disliked various aspects of life, including architecture, including handwriting. So they said, we don't want to carry on using this horrible European medieval system of handwriting. We'll try and write what the Romans did. Okay, but unfortunately, they found it very difficult to find good examples of Roman handwriting. So what they end up doing is finding lots of manuscripts, old manuscripts in Caroline Minuscule, and they developed their own script. I should have given you an example of that, but it's very similar, which is called humanistic script, various versions of that. And it's basically a kind of version of Caroline Minuscule, and it's from there that modern handwriting evolves. Okay. Alp.
Is it really true that the Renaissance humanists confused the Caroline Minuscule?
No, I don't think they were confusing it, but they just they wanted something which was not, I mean, again, they obviously didn't want to base their handwriting on the existing Northern European systems, which were these various Gothic scripts, which some of them were very, very nasty and so on, and something which looked more aesthetic to them, and earlier whatever was probably this. So I'm not attributing to every single humanist this kind of deliberate thing, but there may have been an element of that, okay? But in terms of the genealogy, that's the connection that we can make there, okay? I think that's more or less what I wanted to say today. We've only got 5 minutes left, so I don't want to start getting into the early life of Charlemagne or the times of Charles Martel and so on, because that'll take us over time. And we will focus mostly, obviously, on the figure of Charlemagne. I'll say a little bit about the later Carolingians and so on. So themes to remember is this political unity, which we will examine with Fatih's presentation and the achievements of Charlemagne and so on. And then this cultural unity, whatever we want to call it, which I'm illustrating here with handwriting, and we'll hear more about that from Alp. For the rest of you, if you haven't done so already, please go to Moodle and print out the document which I scanned, had to scan and upload onto Moodle there. It's a docx file, so if you've got an earlier version of Word, you'll have to borrow a friend's computer to print it out or something. I tried to look at it on my own computer in the history department yesterday because I'd done it at home and I couldn't, but there's only a few pages, and we've got, I think, three or maybe four different accounts of the year 800, when Charlemagne was crowned imperator by Pope Leo, okay? And we'll talk a bit about the significance of that. I'm sure Fatih will be talking about that in his presentation. But we'll look at these different accounts and try and be skeptical and say, okay, what really went on? What was Charlemagne doing? Did he want to be emperor? Was it an accident? And so on, and what were the implications of this? And why, what are the differences between these four accounts? There's not a lot, there's only about three or four pages maximum for you to look at there, okay? Any more questions about essays? No? Okay, so I shall see you all happy and jolly on Friday without an essay. I shall send the email reminder about that now. But if you've got any questions about your essays or any other things, you can let me know before then. Next week, probably, I will institute my extra hour policy that we discussed before the Bayram. and the history graduates were saying, oh, blah, blah, other people are doing it. But to try and catch up time, we need to do that. So not this week, because you're doing your essays, but starting next Tuesday, we shall probably have 2 hours together. Okay, enjoy the rest of the week. See you all on Friday.